Good morning, friends. Hey, Brother Mike, back on a Sunday morning podcast. I apologize. I got a late start today. And thank you for tuning in. I'll have this podcast on my Facebook page, Michael W. Smith, and on our Facebook group, HardcoreChristianity.com, on Facebook. And also we're on, as you know, Twitch.tv. You just put in the code HCCADC. That stands for Hardcore Christianity, Arizona Deliverance Center. Thank you for tuning in. Again, I apologize for being late this Sunday. You can contact me directly, Mike at HardcoreChristianity.com, anytime you need to. I always answer all my emails. You can go to the website, HardcoreChristianity.com. You'll see all of our services. We have two live services every week, Thursdays and Friday nights at 7 p.m. Mountain Time at the Arizona Deliverance Center. We have a live deliverance service over Zoom every Wednesday at 6 p.m. If you send me an email, I will send you the ID code and the password every Wednesday night at 6 p.m. Mountain Time. That'd be 5 p.m. Pacific. And you can get healed and delivered right on Zoom with Brother Rick and the Hardcore Ministry team. It's powerful. When you go to the website, you'll see all of our ministry services. We've got a bunch of seminars coming up. The women's seminars in February. The children's healing and deliverance service is in March. If you own a child who needs to be delivered or healed, and they're pre-teens up to age 12, please bring them to the Deliverance Center Saturday at 10 o'clock in March. The schedules and the times are all on the website. I wanted to share with you some interesting things today about Christians and judgment. Christians and judgment. And I want to start off by reading some interesting scripture out of 1 Timothy chapter 3. As you might recall, this section of text is extremely powerful. It's a qualification test. You have to take a test in order to become a bishop or a deacon in the Church of God. You have to take a test. And Paul outlined his test of things that needed to be done for you to qualify for this type of service to God. And he goes down a laundry list of things that people have to do. In our society in the United States, as you know, there's a bunch of people running around the country who are claiming to be prophets and apostles and seers and all kinds of other nonsense. You'll be shocked to know that these people that say these things, or they hand you a business card and said, I'm a prophet, I'm a seer, I'm an apostle, haven't even gone through the qualification list to be a bishop or a deacon that Paul outlines in 1 Timothy chapter 3. Somebody claims to be something, gives himself a certain title, always red flag that person. Okay? Always red flag that person. There's another false doctrine going around out there called the apostolic order. There's so many messed up things out there. It's unbelievable. But the simplicity of Christ is always the best way to go. And you can't get any simpler than Paul's qualification list for being in the ministry. It's right here. But in verse 5, Paul explains that you're not supposed to go into the ministry if you've got a jacked up family. If a person doesn't know how to, Paul said, rule their own family, their own house, he said, how in the world are you going to take care of God's house? So he says a person is to be an elder or a deacon in the church has to have their family under control, so to speak. And he said in verse 6, now listen to this carefully, they must not be a novice. A neophytus in Greek is a rookie. He must not be a rookie, lest being lifted up with pride. Now, that Greek word is really interesting in that verse. Tufaomai is the Greek word. It means to blow smoke in front of somebody so they can't see straight or see clearly. Yeah, it doesn't say blow smoke up a certain area, but you kind of get the gist of it. Okay, that's what these people are who claim to be prophets, apostles, and seers from a special apostolic order of something. The whole thing's ridiculous. They're blowing smoke in your ear, which isn't good. Okay, that's not good. Right? Please be careful with that. But Paul says to be an elder or a deacon, not a prophet or a seer, you have to have your house in order, and you cannot be a rookie. Because if you put a rookie in a position of authority, what's going to happen is they're going to be lifted up with pride. Okay, they're going to be filled with self-conceit is what that Greek word means, tufaomai. And he will fall into the condemnation of the devil. This is the King James Version. The Greek word for condemnation there is krima, and it means judgment, the judgment of Satan. When you become a born-again Christian, the Christian is continuously judged, not by God, but by Satan. It says it right here, 1 Timothy 3, verse 6. The judgment of the devil, diabolos, Satan. It says, moreover, he must have a good report of those who are outside, lest he fall into the reproach onidismus. Onidismus means verbal abuse. Unless he fall into the reproach, the verbal abuse, and the snare of diabolos, the devil, Satan. The Greek word for snare there is really interesting. It's pagis. It means a trap you fell into you didn't see coming. You were walking along and then, boop, almost like a cartoon where you have a trap door. The spirit of rejection is the most prolific demon in the United States. I see him all the time in my ministry and have seen him for years. I was loaded with rejection demons years ago before I became a Christian, and then carried that spirit into my Christian life. And I struggled for years until I went through deliverance in 2004. But that rejection demon is brutal because he's always telling the born-again Christian, hey, God's mad at you. He's disappointed at you. He's judging you. You're being judged. He's rejecting you. He's not happy with you. He thinks you suck. Those are all lies from the spirit of rejection. He's lying to you so you will not fulfill your destiny, and so you will not complete this list that you have to complete for to be an elder or a deacon. Always remember that Christians and sinners, they were all judged on the cross of Calvary. God judged humanity at the cross, and the punishment God dealt out for sin was taken out into the broken body of Jesus. He was slaughtered for us. And that was the judgment of God falling upon humanity. It missed humanity and it fell on Jesus. Jesus, as your pastor once said, paid the price for your sin. For he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace, the Hebrew word there is punishment, the punishment for our peace fell upon him. And by his mallops, wounds from the whips, by his wounds, we are healed. Utterly amazing. God is not judging you anymore. He already judged you. You were found guilty. I was found guilty. And the judgment of God fell on us, but was intercepted by Jesus on the cross of Calvary. It was intercepted. And God's judgment fell on Christ and did not fall on you. You got mercy. You got salvation. You got freedom. You got forgiveness. The Greek word for forgiveness, as you know, is aphiemi. It means to release, to be released. When you received Christ as your Savior, and when you put your faith in the blood of Jesus, God released you from your sins and is no longer judging you for your sins. A child of God is not being judged by God. But as I read in 1 Timothy just a minute ago, all born-again Christians are judged by Satan, and it comes through the law of sowing and reaping. The law of sowing and reaping, as real as gravity, says that whatever a man or woman sows, that's what they will also reap. That's the law of God. That applies to sinners or saints, unbelievers or believers, doesn't matter. That's the law. But God is not judging you anymore. He already judged you. You've already been judged at Calvary. And God, the Holy Ghost, in John chapter 8, went out of his way to put this story in the New Testament. It's only in there once of what God's talking about when he talks about mercy for you. John chapter 8, verse 1. Jesus went to the Mount of Olives, and early in the morning, he came again to the temple. And as you know, Jesus would go into Herod's temple in the outer court, and he would teach. And massive crowds would follow him there. And it says, quote, all the people came to him, and he sat down. He sat down and taught them. And the scribes and Pharisees, it says, brought a woman. Greek word gune. Gune is the Greek term used to describe a wife. Okay, so they found some woman that was cheating on their husband. And it says she was taken in adultery. Okay. And they set her in the midst, in front of everybody, including Jesus. They just brought her and set her right in the middle. And the Greek word for to set her in the middle there, histemi, means to stand and face somebody. So they brought her and they stood her in the midst facing Christ. And they were going to use this woman as a tool. This guy's wife was sleeping with another guy. And how do we know it was another guy? Because the Greek word moikia, adultery, means heterosexual sex. Heterosexual sex, any kind of sex. So if a male has sexual relations with any female, a child, an adult, doesn't matter. That is moikia. That is adultery, heterosexual sex. If a male has sex with another male, or female has sex with another female, that is fornication, Greek word porneia. That is not adultery, moichia. Okay? So this woman who's married is having an affair or something. Anyway, she gets caught having intercourse with somebody, it says here. They leave the guy go. They drag her down to the temple, to the outer court, and they stand her right in front of Jesus. They pull her up and stand her there, accusing her and judging her. And they said to Jesus, didaskalos. Didaskalos is a Greek word for teacher. They didn't call him, they didn't see him as anything other than a teacher. Very disrespectful. Teacher, this gune, this woman, this wife was taken in adultery. And in the very act of adultery. So they caught her in bed with a guy. Now Moses in the law commanded us, Moses commanded us that we should stone her. And that's true. Moses did do that. Leviticus 20 and Deuteronomy chapter 22. If you were caught committing moichia, adultery, you were committing a capital offense and you were to be stoned to death. Then they said, but what do you say? Okay, they're trying to set him up. They think they've got him by the throat. Because if he says no, then he contradicted the law of Moses, proving he's a false prophet and a false teacher. And if he says yes, he's going to damage this glorious message that God was now sending to you now, them there, then. Mercy. I desire mercy and not sacrifices, says Jehovah, says Yahweh, says Yehovah, the Lord. And now Jesus is in a quandary here. They got him cornered, so to speak. But friends, understand and know this, that the Holy Ghost is never cornered. He's never been cornered. He's not about to start now. So the Spirit of the Lord Jesus, bends over, it says. He stoops down. It says kupto means to bend forward. Kupto, down. He stoops down on the ground. And with his finger, he writes on the ground. What's he writing there? Well, easy to figure out. He's looking up at one person through the gift of knowledge, and he sees this person and knows that he's a thief. So he writes down, Jacob, klepto, a thief. And he sees another guy, picks out his sin, writes that down, and he's only doing it to the adults. The adults that brought her and stood him in front of her, stood her in front of him. He's doing it to them, the ones that brought her. And he's writing in the sand there, their sins. Then he mentions sin. This whole thing is about sins. And he said, he that is without sin, let him first throw a stone at her. He then immediately goes back down. It says here, he stooped down, kupto, he bends forward. He's writing on the ground with his finger. And he writes on the ground. Once again, he's writing another guy's name, another guy's sin, this guy's name, this guy's sin. He's writing it down there, proving and showing to them that there isn't anybody standing there who is without sin, which gives you the divine understanding of mercy. The divine understanding of mercy. What is it? There is none, no one sinless. All have sinned. There is none righteous. No, not one. Why is that important? Because mercy is meant for people who've sinned. He again stoops down, he writes on the ground, and it says, and they which heard it, being convicted of their sin, Elenko is the Greek word, and it means to be convinced or admonished for something. Saints, I want you to listen to me carefully. Conviction of the Holy Spirit is one of the greatest blessings you'll ever receive in your life. It's hard to believe how beautiful it is. Admittedly, I'm with you on this one. It's painful when it happens. It's always been painful for me too, because conviction is meant to point out something you said or did that was wrong and that God is not pleased with. But the demon of rejection always says, that's God condemning you, crema, judging you. It actually isn't. It's God loving you. Conviction is love, but condemnation is demonic. It says they were convicted, Elenko, by their own conscience. Sunedesis. Now, your conscience is the seat of your morality, and that's where the Holy Spirit convicts you of your sin. You cannot become a born-again Christian or a child of God if you have not had any conviction of sin. If you become a Christian and you haven't been convicted of your sin, you are what Ray Comfort in California would call a false convert, and it's not real. They were convicted, admonished by their own conscience, and they went out one by one, beginning at the eldest. Why? Because the older people had a lot more sin in their life than the younger people, obviously, because they lived longer. And even to the last person that brought Jesus, this wife, stood her in front of him so he would judge her and murder her. And they went out one by one, even to the last one, it says here. And it says Jesus was left alone with the Gune, the wife, standing in the midst. She was still standing there when all this happened. And it says Jesus lifted up himself, meaning he anakupto, he bent back up straight. He was bending over, writing on the ground. Then he bent back up straight like that and saw nobody, but only the wife. He says to her, Gune, woman, wife, where are your accusers? Isn't that where are your accusers? Listen, I want to tell your rejection demon something today. First of all, I want to tell him to go screw himself. Secondly, I want to tell him that there's nobody standing around you this morning condemning you. There's no one judging you this morning. They're all gone. Where are your accusers? Has no man condemned you? Now, this is the Greek word katakrino. The previous Greek word was krema. That means to evaluate a certain situation. Katakrino means to evaluate the situation, come to a conclusion, and pass a judgment. Translation, evaluation of adultery, decide it's a sin, execute the judgment, stoning. Jesus said to her, where are your accusers? Is there anybody else here, katakrino, judging you, evaluating you, determining that you are a sinner, and sentencing you to be stoned, is what he said, essentially. And she said, nobody. There's nobody here. Udis. Nothing. No one. No one, Lord. She calls him Kurios, Lord, which is what he should have been called and a lot more. But the other people who had no respect for Jesus called him teacher. Anybody could be a teacher. She said, Lord, nobody's here anymore. And Jesus said to her, neither do I, katakrino, evaluate you, pronounce you an adulterous sinner and condemn you to stoning. Evaluate, reach a conclusion, issue a sentence. I'm not going to do that either. But he said, and he didn't say this, but he meant it, because of the law of sowing and reaping, he told her, go and sin no more. Meketzi. Meketzi means any further. Go and stop committing adultery so that the law of sowing and reaping does not judge you. Whatever a man or woman sows, that shall they also reap. And here God is illustrating for you to see that God is not judging you. So let's practicalize this, okay? Yeah. You got up this morning, something bad happened. And the kids screwed up. The wife screwed up. The husband did something stupid. The normal stuff. Normal stuff. And you go, you know, so you say, you know, I don't know. Damn it. I'm so sick of that. I am so pissed off. I'm getting mad. Uh-oh. And then you catch yourself. Click. Oh, man. I did it again. I'm not supposed to be doing that. Lord, please forgive me. While you were sinning, okay, when you said that, when you reacted like that, when you felt that, when you responded that way, that was a sin. While you were doing that, God was not judging you. He already judged you at Calvary. You've already been judged for your sin. Okay? The devil was judging you. And so he heard you say it. The demons heard you say it. And now they are going to bring upon you the results of what you sowed. So whatever you sow, that shall you also reap. And the demons will bring the reaper to you. And at the end of your life, if you don't repent of your sin, they will bring you the grim reaper. And you will be in trouble. You can't conceive or believe. I want to tell your rejection demon something today. Number one, go screw yourself. Number two, there's nobody here condemning you. It's not happening. You don't have any accusers. God is not accusing you. He is not judging you. He already judged you at Calvary. But as Paul warned Timothy, hey, you can be judged, but it's by the devil. He judges the false accuser who accuses you before God. He judges you every day. Krima. Your Heavenly Father is not judging you. Will God stop you from reaping what you sow? No, until you repent and ask for forgiveness and change. The point I want to leave with you today is there is judgment for Christians. It happens all the time. But you're not being judged by God. You're being judged by the devil, and he hates your guts, and he wants to destroy you. Wednesday night at 6 o'clock Mountain Time, you can get on the Zoom deliverance service, and you can get that rejection demon out of you. If you feel God is condemning you, doesn't like you, is disappointed in you, thinks you suck, if you have those feelings out of your soul is the seat of your emotions, if you're feeling negativity about yourself, listen, no way it's coming from God. There's no way. That's a rejection demon. You're not being judged by God. You might be judged by the devil if you keep sinning. Absolutely, you're going to reap what you sow. But your Heavenly Father is not doing it to you. And immediately when you come back, the moment you ask for forgiveness, it's there. Because there's no judgment from God. There's no judgment from God. Does that make any sense to you today? I hope it does, because it's so important. This rejection demon, he's a cold-blooded killer. And the last verse he ever wants you to read is Romans 8:1. Of course, there's therefore now no what? Condemnation. There it is. Katakrima, the Greek word. Katakrima. To evaluate, to come to a conclusion, and to issue a judgment. God doesn't do that to his children. It doesn't happen. But if you walk in the flesh, now that's a different story. The devil will judge you, and he will bring you hell and fire to breakfast to destroy you. And you can trust him. Okay, a lot of people think the devil's not faithful. He is faithful. You can trust him. You go back into your sin, you start deliberately sinning, and he will bring you the reaper. And he'll be happy to do it. But if you repent, he has no power over you. You win. You don't have to put up with it. You are not condemned by God. You are not judged by God, period. And your rejection demon is lying to you. That is not true. That is not true. God is not mad at you. He's not upset with you. He's not hurt because he dislikes you or disappointed in you. Yeah, he's hurt that you're hurting yourself. Now, that's a different story. That's a whole different Bible study. But God is not condemning you. And the blood of Jesus works at full throttle 100% until the moment you drop dead. So if you're alive, particularly if you're listening to this podcast, you are eligible for full forgiveness, 100% mercy from God. You can't get away from sowing and reaping. Now, if you continue to live in sin, if you continue with bad attitudes, if you continue to word curse stuff, that's a different story. It's another Bible study. But I'm talking about the woman, the wife caught in adultery. They stood her up there expecting Jesus to condemn her because Moses had condemned her. The law condemned her. But God sent us the new covenant. And in that new covenant is not blood sacrifices from animals. It is the blood sacrifice from the Son of the living God that works until the moment you drop dead. So if you want to repent, nobody can stop you if you choose to do that of your own free will. You can't lose in 2023. Why? God is not mad at you anymore. He took his rage out on Jesus. The anger of God fell on the cross of Calvary. The judgment of God fell on the cross of Calvary. It was heading toward us, and Jesus jumped in and took the bullet for you, so to speak. And because of that, you can repent now. Bang. You can do it anytime you want to. And on Wednesday night at the Zoom service, Thursday and Friday nights at the Arizona Deliverance Center, or you can watch our services on our YouTube channel, youtube.com/houseofhealingaz. You can cast that rejection demon out of you in 2023, and you don't have to condemn yourself ever again. You don't need to condemn yourself ever again. See you next time.